Welcome back to Turning Hard Times into Good Times. I'm your host, Jay Taylor, and I'm really glad to have with me once again John Cimpaglia. John joined Sprott in April of 2010. He is the chief operating officer of the Sprott's gold ETFs. Welcome, John. Thanks for joining me again.
Thanks for having me.
Really good to talk to you. A lot happier circumstances than when you and I spoke a couple of years ago when gold was on its way down, and a very discouraging marketplace that was, but you guys have held in there, and things do seem to be turning around, at least during the first couple of months of this year. What's your take on the gold market now, John? What do you keep your eyes on most closely as you watch this market every day, the gold market itself?
Right. Well, I think one of the things that we look very closely at to try to gauge investor sentiment and behavior is looking at things that are visible, such as the number of ounces of gold held by ETFs, because ETFs are such an accessible way for investors to express a view on the marketplace. We look at a great measure that's available in Bloomberg that aggregates all the ounces of gold held by ETFs around the world. And this number peaked at 85 million ounces back in 2013. It fell as low as about 46 million ounces at the end of 2015 and is now at 55 million ounces. So in just 2 months, 9 million ounces has been added collectively to the gold ETFs around the world. We think that's a really good sign of how investor interest has rebounded in the sector as they're looking for a safe haven investment with all of the increased volatility we're seeing in currencies, the plunging interest rates both on a nominal and a real yield basis that we're seeing, negative interest rates around the world, and I think the last number I saw was $7 trillion of sovereign bonds now trading with a negative yield. So gold, you know, we joke sometimes that gold is now a high-yield asset because it doesn't yield anything unless you loan it out versus putting your money in a five-year bond with a negative interest rate on it.
Yeah, interesting, because, you know, one of the main reasons people always gave for not owning gold is the fact that you don't get any interest on it. So I guess negative interest rates certainly remove that complaint, and of course we've had near negative rates now for a prolonged period of time, and still gold didn't perform that well, but it does seem to be turning around now. So ultimately, I guess people were just buying the financial assets, which continued to rise very dramatically, and maybe there's some problems there now too. We could see, at least there's certain quite a few people that think that the equity markets in general may be topping out. So if there's no place else to go, maybe people end up going back to gold. Well, let's talk about your funds. You have the Sprott company has two gold mining ETFs. One is for larger mining companies, and that trades under the symbol SGDM. And then you have another one that's for the smaller, the juniors, that trades on the New York Exchange as well under the symbol SGDJ. What is the size threshold to qualify for the larger ETF as opposed to the smaller one?
Yeah, and for the larger, the senior miner index that we co-developed with our partner on the fund, Zacks Index Services in Chicago, we're generally looking for companies in the $1 billion and up market cap range. We're trying to find the companies that are more senior producing companies, and the reality is there are not that many companies in that gold universe with that market cap anymore. So it's a fairly small universe. What makes our index very different, though, is the way we select the companies in that universe, and secondarily, how we weight them. Most funds in the marketplace are what they call market cap weighted, which simply says you take the number of shares outstanding in a company, you multiply it by its price per share, and that gives you the total value of its market capitalization. The larger the market capitalization, the larger the weighting it becomes in an index. To us, you know, that's what you would describe as a quantity-based approach, and it doesn't really make sense to us as investors in the gold space, because we'd rather focus on a quality-based approach. We'd rather focus on companies that are delivering certain attributes in terms of their financial results, using those metrics as a way to figure out how to weight them in an index. So, for example, in our our senior miners index, we look for two factors specific to each company to try to determine the weighting. We look for the revenue growth of a company, and we look for its long-term debt to equity ratio. And those are two really important metrics, we believe, because revenue is the lifeline to any kind of capital-intensive business like a mining company. It really is the cleanest measure of its production quarter to quarter. And we also look at its balance sheet strength because it's a very capital-intensive industry. You need to have flexibility with the financing to develop new mines, and you definitely need the balance sheet strength to weather the downturns that inevitably come in a cyclical industry like mining.
Well, for sure. And I'm looking at your holdings, and it might be interesting to mention to my listeners before we go any further that they should go, really, it's SprotsETF.com, Sprots, that's Sprott, S-Sprott, let me start again, Sprott ETFs, ETFS.com, SprottETFS.com. And there, John, very interestingly, every day it's possible for investors to go there and see exactly what their portfolio contains. And regarding the strategy that you were just outlining, I look at your larger cap universe here, the companies, the bigger companies. I see that Franco Nevada, you had to start today at 15.69%, Agnico Eagle 13.86%, and Goldcorp at 13.58%, and then it falls all the way down to 4.91% for Barrick Goldcorp. What do you see then? Is there income growth in those top three companies outstanding? Do you see that? Or balance sheet, what is it that sets them apart from the rest of this crowd?
Sure. Yeah, just to speak to your first point, one of the benefits of an ETF is that the holdings have to be disclosed every day, and we put those on our website. And in this kind of environment, people want transparency in terms of what they own in their underlying portfolios. But speaking specifically to how we're weighting the index, the companies in the index, every quarter we're scoring the companies. So each company in the universe, we're taking a snapshot, looking at its latest quarterly financial results, and looking at its one-year revenue growth, and we're looking at its balance sheet. So, for example, a company like Franco Nevada, the reason why it has such a high weighting in our index is, first of all, it has no debt on its balance sheet. Mm-hmm. Being a royalty and streaming company, it has that advantage of not having any long-term debt. So it scores obviously well in that regard. When you look at its revenue year over year, it's only fallen by a few percent, which is, on a relative basis, much better than some of the companies such as Barrick Gold, which has fallen about 11%.
Mm-hmm.
We like to look for companies with that financial strength. You know, I think it's interesting, Franco Nevada just recently did a $900 million plus equity raise, and it kind of reinforces to us, you know, companies that are able to raise that kind of capital in an environment where we just came out of a four-year bear market tells us that the marketplace is pretty comfortable giving more capital to a company like Franco Nevada. You know, it's been able to opportunistically provide capital to some of the traditional mining companies that have had some missteps, whether that was problems with mines or acquisitions that have gone bad on them or whatever. So longer term, you know, that we think that company will be well positioned in the index. But it's a dynamic process. The companies change all the time.
Mm-hmm.
If a company like Barrick, who has been making improvements with its debt load, if it continues on that path, the index will score it higher and its weight should come up over time. So I think it's important that it's not just, you know, set it and forget it. You have to look at the companies every quarter and, you know, reevaluate them, see where they're standing.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe you could comment then on Agnico Eagle and Goldcorp.
Sure. Well, on the revenue side for Agnico Eagle, very similar to Franco Nevada, year-over-year revenue is down about 4%. Mm-hmm. And its debt load isn't too bad. It does carry, obviously, some debt, but not too bad. Goldcorp, even though the stock struggled a little bit, the model basically rewards it because its revenue growth has been quite spectacular, even though we've been in a fairly soft period for gold.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at its Q4 2015 revenue versus the same quarter the prior year, and that's how we do our measurement, its revenue was up 39%. Now, the market, you know, may take some time for the company to be re-rated, but the model is trying to find the companies that are actually growing revenue, which means growing their production profile.
So I would just, again, like to suggest to my listeners, go to Sprott ETFs, Sprott ETFs with an S there, .com, and you can see exactly every name that's in the portfolio, the large cap, the larger cap, or the 1 billion plus market cap companies that John was just talking about. John, the same thing holds true. Of course, people can also see the junior index as well. There you have, I know that most of the companies that you own are in North America, predominantly in Canada even, I believe, but your largest holding among the juniors is a South African company. How does that come about? Are there must be something outstanding about this company to get you to buy a South African mining company?
Right, and the rule for that index on the junior gold miners is that the company has to have a listing in either Canada or the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And the number one holding in that index right now, Sibanye Gold, has an ADR that trades on New York.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the reason why it's in there. For that index, we take a totally different approach. Smaller cap companies, obviously, at a very different stage of development. They have very different risks. They have very different options in terms of how they can finance themselves to actually, you know, explore and develop mines and get to production. There, we're trying to focus on companies that are between $250 million and $2 billion of market cap. So we do have some intermediate companies in that index. But the factors that we're using for the scoring methodology, we look at revenue growth, but not on a percentage basis. We actually look at it on a dollar basis.
Mm-hmm.
We're actually looking for the companies that are actually becoming producing mines. We want to see that step change in terms of dollar of revenue. The second thing we're looking for is price momentum. And what that basically means is we're looking at how strong the stocks have performed mm-hmm. over the last 6 months. And what that tells us is it helps us to identify leadership in the group. So if a stock has very strong price momentum, like Sibanye has right now, we will reward the company because that's basically signaling us that something is working at the company. On the flip side, if the stock's price momentum is very poor, it's usually a sign that the company is having problems, whether it's drill results, you know, unable to get financing. There's just something not working there. So we try to emphasize the companies with the strongest price momentum and de-emphasize the companies with the weakest price momentum. It's a very interesting methodology because the dispersion of companies among the junior and intermediate is much more wide, I think, than the senior. And, you know, we think longer term those factors are going to help to, you know, bifurcate the market in terms of the companies that have a greater chance of success of becoming senior miners versus companies that are much more speculative and, in our opinion, require much more technical due diligence that an active manager should be implementing. For example, what Rick Rule and his group down in California are doing and to, you know, determine which stocks to buy for clients.
Mm-hmm. Sure. You know, as I look at your junior list there, you've got a company that is, I would think, would almost qualify for the other listing, and that would be Detour Gold Corp. Is their market cap not large enough yet, or would think it would be?
Yeah, there are some companies that will overlap between the two funds,
mm-hmm.
And we just had to do it that way because the companies, you know, some of these intermediate companies, for example, last year, 2015, they got so beaten up.
Yes.
That they started to tip into our lower threshold for market
uh-huh.
cap.
Mm-hmm.
So when we rebalanced the index back in November, you know, companies like Yamana and Tahoe Resources, they actually, you know, moved from the senior index down into the junior index.
Mm-hmm.
And if I when I look back in hindsight, that was a very opportune time because we were able to pick up a lot of intermediate companies at very bombed-out prices at the end of November. And those companies have done very well in the last 2 months.
Well, they certainly have. I mean, I've very interesting selection, the top five I'm looking at here. Oceana Gold is a company that I've followed for quite a while. Tahoe Resources with a new acquisition coming up the way it looks. And, yeah, it's a lot of really fascinating things happening here. But, again, your South African holding there at 12.38%, Detour 9.78%, Yamana Gold 6.82%, Tahoe 6.3%, and Oceana Gold Corp. Really interesting companies, for sure. It seems to me what happens in a bull market like this, you mentioned that initially people buy the ETFs, they buy the gold because they want to get out of the currencies, perhaps. They want some sort of their currencies are losing. Most currencies have been losing against gold for some time, but now with all the sort of chaos that's in the markets, I suppose, and then they start to look for shares to buy. And the first place I would think general fund managers go would be names like Barrick and names like Newmont and Goldcorp and those names. Then it would seem that they might be a bit expensive compared to some of the others that you've got towards the top as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. I agree with that assessment. What we have seen, what we have heard from some of the sell-side research analysts that we follow is they've been getting inbound calls from generalist investors, predominantly United States, saying, hey, I need to get some gold exposure in my portfolio for probably the first time in 3 or 4 years, and they don't want to do any analysis on individual companies. So what they will quickly default to is, you know, give me Barrick or give me Newmont just because they're big and liquid, and, you know, it just gives me a way to put the trade on very cost effectively. So in the recent rally, we've seen those companies do quite well. We've also seen the companies, I'm going to call them the companies with marginal economics. So they may have they may be kind of marginal from a profitability perspective, or they might have excessive debt loads. We've seen those companies snap back the most because they definitely were hit the hardest in the downturn.
Mm-hmm.
The higher quality companies have kind of lagged a little bit because they've held up better, you know, in the downturn. So we expect that as the generalist investor comes back to the market, that, you know, they're going to start in the larger cap names and then slowly start to cycle into the mid cap names and then eventually the small cap names. So we see the rotation happening amongst the biggest names right now.
Well, I've certainly seen that. I've been around these markets, I guess, quite a few years more than you, John, because I'm quite a bit older than you are, I think. But it certainly has been the pattern that the big names, the household names, get fed first and then down the food chain. And then, so I think the juniors a lot of times can be, can outproduce longer term in a bull market better than the seniors. Which of the two funds, I know both of these are fairly young funds, but which of the two have performed better?
If you look at the if you look at our junior index, it's up around 49% year to date, and This is as of today.
Wow!
And that compares to about 28% for the senior index. So we're seeing what you would, you know, generally expect: smaller cap names outperforming in a bull market rally. But in terms of the capital flows into the categories, You're seeing the capital flows go into the seniors, even though they haven't had the same, you know, leverage price performance to gold.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure smart portfolio managers will be looking at overvalued stocks and looking for a way to move down the food chain and pick up quality juniors. And certainly if the price of gold remains up and the market remains strong, the smaller companies will be growing both on their balance sheet and top line growth, those things that you look for the bigger companies. Just one more question that I can think of right now that I'd like to ask you about with respect to the juniors and the companies that fit into that portfolio. Do you look for, do those companies have to be at some sort of, say, the feasibility stage if they're not producing, or is there some level? Because I have my eyes on a bunch of junior exploration companies, I guess, that probably don't fit that. Well, first of all, you said they need to be a $250 million market cap, I believe you said. But do they, I guess by definition, probably most of the companies, if not all of them, that are in there would have passed through a feasibility study but would not necessarily be in production yet, or are they all in production?
Yeah, the way that the rules of the index work is we don't screen for whether companies at feasibility or pre-feasibility. We're really using the market cap as a barometer to try to indicate to us what stage of development it is. And we design this specifically with a larger threshold for inclusion in the index at 250 million. And the reason we picked that higher threshold was we just think it's very hard to arbitrarily pick companies with much smaller market caps unless you really dig into the companies and understand the management teams, the deposits. And so that kind of work is best done by analysts and geologists, not the computer.
Sure.
In our experience.
Yeah, understood. Well, it is a unique way of picking stocks. I think you guys have come up with some really good ideas. We'll certainly be watching to see how the funds perform. And I would just tell my listeners once again to go to Sprott, SPROTTETFS.com to catch up with the work that John and his team are doing. And anything else you'd like to add, John, before we conclude our discussion today?
Well, I think one of the things that's also interesting that we've been looking at is when you look at historical bear markets in the gold space, one of our fund managers shared a great chart with me, and this was the AMEX Gold Bugs Index, HUI, and he looked at it over the last three bear markets, back in the early 80s, down 80%, in the late 1990s, down 76%, and the current drawdown, which came, to January 18th is when we troughed, another 80% decline. So in terms of the magnitude of the three bear markets, almost exactly the same in decline, and also the duration. This one has actually been longer from a duration perspective, but they've all fallen between 76 and 80%. And what was very interesting to me is following those two previous drawdowns, the subsequent peak gains was 760% and 607%.
Oh, okay. Well, that's very encouraging. If indeed we're on to the next leg up in what I think is really a secular bull market that began in the early 2000s, but I don't know if you would see it that way or not, but that certainly gives us something to look forward to then if this is the real McCoy, John.
Well, I mean, I'm not trying to predict those kinds of returns, but I think it's interesting to see how far we are. You know, even though we've bounced 40 or 50% in some of these stocks in 2 months, we're still a long way away from previous peaks.
Right, exactly. Well, of course, you can't take past as a prologue to the future, that's for sure. So, well, I want to thank you very much, John. Really interesting, and I hope we can talk to you again sometime, maybe almost quarterly or something like that, to catch up on what you're doing there, and hopefully we'll have some more green on the screen day in and day out going forward, because Lord knows we've seen enough red, haven't we, in the last 4 or 5 years. So,
absolutely. I'd love to come back on. Thank you very much for having me.